Hi everyone, it's Renee, your instructor. I wanted to give you a little bit of an orientation on how to take notes for online lectures. So if you've looked at YouTube for these, I mean, there's so many different ways. The best is probably using iPad for note taking, but the method I'm going to show you can be used with an iPad, with a tablet, or in this case with a dual screen on your laptop, and you can even do it with regular paper. So these are Cornell notes, and you've probably heard of those before and have been taught how to use them before. I think the difference here is that you're doing it with an online lecture. My lectures tend to be more reading, not so much like a textbook, but more as if I'm sitting with you. At least that's what I hope they're like. So with this one is on the scientific method, and I wanted to show you how I laid this out. So the scientific method lecture is about 4 pages, and as I said, it's very readable. I've got some links in here that leads you to other articles as well, but for this example, I'm just using the information that's on the lecture. So using the Cornell notes, you start with the title or the topic of the lecture. And so for this case, scientific method. On the left side are the cues. On the right side are notes. And then at the bottom is the summary section. Okay? So in the cues, you will have the main points, keywords, and questions. And these are the topics that, or these are the headlines that should be on the left side, cues. In the notes section, you'll have examples, details, and definitions, okay? So what I've done is I've just kind of laid out a few examples for you to start you off. So under questions, I put, what is biblical science? Because here, in the second paragraph, I talk about biblical science, and I explain a bit about what it is and what it meant at the time and what it means now. So I give you kind of an idea here. And so I very briefly write in my notes the definition of what is biblical science. So I'm trying to give you an idea of what it is, and that is science that substantiates the Bible. This was true then in the time of Copernicus, and then it's also true today for biblical archaeologists. Okay. What is sound versus unsound science? This is in the following paragraphs, and this regards, actually it's in the first one too, it regards particularly George W. Bush, who used these terms in his presidency, sound versus unsound science. And he used them specifically to demonstrate differences in science that aren't really there. So he tried to suggest that there are some sciences that are valid and some that are invalid, or some that are good and some that are bad. Well, neither of these are true. So what he was specifically was trying to say is that stem cell research at the time he was proposing was unsound. Basically that it was invalid, which was not the case at the time, nor is it today. But it was the first time we had a head of a government, in the 20th century that was trying to demonstrate the scientific method was invalid. Okay, so this was a tough hit on science in America. And I go on to explain a bit about what that was about. Then we get to Trump. And I have a New York Times article here. You can click on that later. But basically, during Trump's presidency, I have a statement here that says that he was one of the most anti-environment, anti-science presidents we've ever had. And that is supported by this article. Okay. So this is what it means to when we talk about sound versus unsound. Now the reason why is written here is that it's supposed to prevent scientific research on stem cells in America, but it's also to cause Americans to not rely on scientists or the scientific. Scientific perspective. Okay? Now, this means something very particular. So, if we can say that science is not valid or is in any way dubious, then anything that scientists would proclaim as valid or proven would be cause for people to say, oh, I don't think that's true. And I'll give you an example of that in a bit. Okay. So then we get to the main points. What are the main points of this lecture? One of them is that scientific method is a process that prevents bias and misrepresentation. So that is in these two paragraphs. And you can see here it prevents bias, misrepresentation, and false information. That's the main point of the article. The scientific method is a process that prevents bias, misrepresentation, and false information. Okay? When we go down to key words, we have hypotheses and theory. And I've briefly covered the definition for both. A hypothesis is a statement based on observation that has not been tested and is not proven. Okay, that's very important because oftentimes there is a huge misconception of the terms and a misuse where theory is actually used more often than hypotheses and in that place. So theory then is a hypothesis that has been tested and proven. So you will notice next time you watch pretty much any kind of crime show, they'll say, well, I think that this person is the murderer, but that's just a theory. In fact, what they're saying is they have the proof that that person is the murderer, but they don't. So what they should be saying is that person is the murderer, and that's my hypothesis because I have not proved it in any way. So there's a huge misinterpretation of the use of the term, and I'm really hoping that you all will not perpetuate that misconception. Okay, now, as we go further into this lecture, I provide an example of the misuse of information. There was a case by a then British doctor, Andrew Wakefield, who developed supposed research that demonstrated a link between vaccines and autism. So this was in the 90s, and I'm sure you've all heard of this in some way or another. I've had students whose parents did not want them to have vaccines because of this particular research. Now, the links that I provided here demonstrate why all of this information is not true and why it was basically falsified. He's no longer a doctor. His qualifications were proven to be, well, I don't know that they were false, but he has not been able to renew his license in any country, essentially, because his work produced so much damage and death among different countries that there is no country that wants to support his work whatsoever. So the truth of the matter is that he falsified evidence, absolutely made up cases and symptoms. And as I said, these are in these videos, so you can look at these videos. These come from reputable sources also. So do take a look at those, please. Okay, now what that means is that how was this determined? If we know that the scientific method prevents bias and misrepresentation and false information, how were we able to deduce this? Well, when Andrew Wakefield published his findings in the journal Nature, which is a very reputable science journal, immediately other researchers and medical doctors started to replicate his methods. And they did it exactly as he did. And one of the points about the scientific method is that anybody who follows the same methods should get the same results. And no one did. Experiment after experiment and research and more research until you had more than a dozen different people across the globe trying to replicate his data and could not in any way find the same results. Ultimately, it was determined that and found that he falsified all of this information and completely falsified the research results. Okay, so why this is important is because without the scientific method, there would have been no way to prove that he lied. There would be no way to prove that, in fact, there is no connection between vaccines and autism. And only through the scientific method and the repeatability of the method could it be determined that it was false. So there lies the most valuable aspect of the scientific method to then point out here in the main points, the repeatability, of the scientific method. Okay, so that becomes one of our main points because that is, in this case and many other occasions, has been very helpful in determining what is true and what is not true and what is proven and what is not proven. Okay. As we move on here, I demonstrate the actual steps of the scientific method. There are five of them, and the first is to observe and describe a phenomenon. So in here, you could also add in as main point steps of the method, and then go ahead and list 1 through 5 to make sure you know them, or just do steps of the method and maybe include the steps in detail. You could also use this in detail or as definitions here. And then as we go down further, I provide an example of the use of the method. And in this case, it's looking at yawning as a topic of study. And believe it or not, people actually have studied yawning because it is so strange. And I go through in detail here, so I'm not going to retell it, but it is really funny. So then here, it's not a main point, it's more of an example. So if we go back up to where the examples are supposed to go in notes, we can go here and add yawning experiment. Okay? Oops. And then down in the summary section, we can just summarize the information that we have already from the lecture. And that would be basically the importance of the scientific method is that it prevents bias misrepresentation and false information through repeatability of the data through the repeatability of the data. And then you could talk about the method in more detail here as well if you want to. But this, I think, is a really handy way to break down the lecture instead of just reading it and then trying to do your exercises based on that. With this kind of outline, you can use this on your exam. So I've told you, you can use these on your exams, you can use them on the labs, etc. but this will have